Books on Tape presents Brothers by Da Chen, read by Fyodor Chin, Michael Ng, Stephen O. Young, and Janet Song.
Shento, Chapter 1, 1960, Balan, Southwest China. To tell the tale of my birth, I must start not from the beginning, but from the end to my beginning. I was born twice, really. First, when I tore through my mother's dark passage. The second time, when the old medicine man saved me. The young woman who gave birth to me meant to end it all. Not just her life, but also mine. Right at the moment of my sunrise. She was in a hurry to leap off the cliff atop Mount Balan. But I outraced her swollen legs and slipped out of her womb just as she struggled toward the edge of that fateful precipice. One was left to wonder why she did it, making herself a myth, leaping off the zenith of the mountain with me still attached to her by the rope of life, the entangled umbilical cord. I burst through before she burst off, born in the air, hovering over it all. I imagine her flying off that rugged cliff like an eagle gliding downward, free from her nest, her moorings, her sins, or her final lament, to be forgotten by the wind that fluttered her youthful hair up as she rushed down. We, the twinned and wingless angels, free fell. But the unthinkable happened. The hand of destiny intervened. I, the wailing newborn, falling in the wake of my mother along the face of the vine-crawling cliff, was suddenly caught in the branches of a tea tree growing out of a cave's mouth. In one slowed second that could have lasted a lifetime, the umbilical cord snapped. Arrested by the two springy branches, I let out a frightful scream, my ode to the strenuous tea tree. My mother, the angel of my birth, my death, and I parted in the air, blood a spill, splattering the tea leaves. I bounced, suspended aloft by the branches of the blessed tree. She plunged farther, a diminishing dot of herself, then vanished into the secrecy of the valley below, never to be seen again. Why she chose to sing her death song this early in her life, I would only come to know later. For now, I was left dangling as one could be. But fate intervened once more. Grace descended upon me in the shape of a scrawny village medicine man, old and faithful. When he heard me crying and saw me caught on the wind-blasted cliff, he climbed down to fetch me as a monkey would. Fortunately, he was as nimble as one, for his vocation dictated that he roam the mountain ranges from peak to peak, from valley to valley, and from cave to cave, in search of the rare ginseng and scarce swallow spit, only to be found in the capricious spots reached by birds. He flung himself down, breaking through tree branches, missing a few footholds, nearly dashing himself to death. But on that given day, heaven allowed only one death. Breathlessly, he got hold of me. That was the moment I call my second birth, one given me by the grace of Buddha, through the hand of one who had done his virtuous deeds day and night, caring for a village full of sick and poor. I say Buddha's grace, and it was rightly so. For had another man heard me, and Buddha willing, found his heart wanting to save the little bundle, whether he was a virtuous man or not, he might never have done what the medicine man did, for in the old man's heart rang a lonesome bell of childlessness. The cry I made, the cry he heard, as he would later recount, was that cry deep in the recesses of his soul. It was not just a cry of any boy, but that of his own blood. He was inches away when a blast of wind nearly took me away from it all again. But, one arm holding to a tree root, he reached for me, catching my tiny leg just in time to swing me into the crook of his arm. To save time, to save me, he did what no one dared do before, sliding hundreds of feet down the steep cliff, scraping his knees, his heels, nearly breaking his bones, then running home to his wife for 40 years before the nocturnal mountain cats could smell our bloody trail. The goat was chased and the milk milked. His wife fed me the milk as if it came from her own breasts. Then and there, they named me Shento, the mountaintop, the zenith. He will soar for the sky like our sacred Mount Balan, Baba said. And he will rise toward the heaven, like the spirit of our ancient soul, Mama said. Can we really keep him as our own? Of course. He is a gift from our beloved mountain, a reward for the deeds we have rendered. And he looks like he belongs in my arms, Mama crooned, stroking my cheek. So ends the tale of my birth, and begins the story of my life. The sun waned, and the moon waxed, and I gradually grew to be a sturdy village boy with an appetite of a child 3 years older. Mama fed me with an adult-sized bamboo spoon. No birdie song needed to be sung to get me to eat. I would chow down one spoonful after another until I gave out little burps. My favorite food was sweet, sticky rice cake. In our poor village, where the staple diet was yams, sweet rice was rare and precious. Baba walked miles to visit patients in remote villages to earn extra money for those precious rice cakes. He went to the ancient forest, chopped down the finest bamboo poles, and made a sturdy playpen big enough for me to crawl and sleep in. Baba put the pen near his desk in the infirmary. With Mama's assistance, he saw his patients, dispensed advice, and performed acupuncture with me nearby. Against one wall in the infirmary leaned a massive medicine cabinet containing drawers of herbal medicine that Baba sold to his patients by the ounce and some by the pinch. The drawers were labeled with arcane Chinese inscriptions that only doctors versed in the classics would recognize. I startled Baba one day at 2.5 years by naming and locating 10 of the most common herbs. By 3, I could name more than half of them. When I was 4, I pointed out one day that Baba had pinched the wrong herb for a particular prescription. The correction, Baba said, saved the pregnant woman from having a miscarriage. Baba and Mama were convinced that I was no ordinary boy. From then on, Baba read me classic medicinal texts and schooled me to memorize acupuncture points. One night, lying in bed before falling asleep, I overheard Baba whisper to Mama, "Our son is destined to be the most gifted doctor these mountains will ever know. Imagine how many cures he might find for diseases with his extraordinary mind." "No," Mama retorted. "No. Why would you disagree with that?" "His destiny is beyond your narrow wish," Mama said. "One day, he will lead thousands and rule millions." "Aren't you a bit too ambitious, my dear wife?" I heard Baba say. "Not at all. Don't you see? He suffered tragedy at birth, not unlike many emperors who rose from nothing to the golden throne." Baba was quiet for a moment. "I did read somewhere that tragedy breeds extraordinary men." "Yes. Unfortunately, those great men were never entitled to much happiness." "Oh, I'd much rather he be ordinary and live happily and long enough to see us die," said Baba. "It is too late. His destiny began when he took his first breath off that cliff. It is already great fortune for us to have him for as long as our good Buddha allows." That night, I broke the rule and snuggled into their bed, sleeping between them till the sun rose. But no matter how often they talked about me, they never came near the subject of my birth parents. It was as if once that taboo were broken, the ghost from my past would come to haunt our nearly perfect, though simple life.
10. Chapter 2, 1960, Beijing. I was born the son of General Ding Long, and the only grandchild of two influential families in China, the Longs, a banking dynasty, and the Xias, a military powerhouse. The two prominent families were as different as night and day. Grandfather Xia had no education, but he walked with Chairman Mao in the Long March, a pedigree that won him the lifelong post of Commander-in-Chief of China's Navy, Air Force, and Army.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.